In this module, we'll discuss about OpenStack block storage service that's called Cinder. So, in this module, mainly we'll be discussing about the block storage service, that's the Cinder. Then use cases where we'll be using Cinder, and then we'll see the features. Then we'll see the supported storage backend which we can use with Cinder, and then various components inside our Cinder, that's block service, and also we'll see basic Cinder related commands and the workflow for Cinder. And at the end of the module, we will see the updated lab build out. So what is that block storage service? So this is a project name of OpenStack block storage, that's Cinder. It provides on-demand self-service persistent block storage to the OpenStack instances. So that means if the user wants to add a persistent block storage to the instances for that user, particular user project, he can add by himself. He no need to depend on any cloud provider or that admin to give that. So if you have available storage volume from Cinder, he can add by himself. Also, Cinder enables to have software defined block storage either via abstraction or automation, and it works on top of traditional backend storage device. So to use Cinder, you can use any traditional backend storage device like HP 3PAR and all those things to enable the Cinder or block storage service on your OpenStack platform. So it is similar to the Amazon Elastic Block Store, or what you can say like EBS. So it gives a similar kind of feature in OpenStack to have a elastic block storage or volume service. And in Cinder, volume management and snapshots are possible if it is on a supported storage vendor. So suppose if you are using HP 3PAR as a backend storage for your Cinder, you can do the various volume management activities, and also you can take or delete or manage snapshots, and also you can create or delete volumes, or what you can say like LANs on the external resources via Cinder. So if you are attaching a backend storage to Cinder, you can create LANs or volumes on that backend storage. So this is various use cases where we'll be using Cinder. So first use case is like if you need a storage for your running VM to have, you will be adding Cinder as a disk volume on the host. And also where you'll have a performance sensitive situations like production application is running, like suppose you have a web server running where you want to store the data for your particular website. In that situation, you will be using Cinder to have that storage attached to your running VM. Or if you are deploying a traditional IT system, like where you have server client kind of architecture where you will be storing data, either static data or dynamic data, in that situation you will be using Cinder. Also, if you are deploying any database driven application or you are developing and testing system, so in that situations you will be using Cinder to provide the block storage functionality to the running instances in OpenStack. So and Cinder will be suitable for workloads like where you have a high change of content, like suppose you are providing some kind of service via your running instance where you'll be like keep on writing or modifying the data. In that, if you are doing something like that, Cinder is that perfect candidate for that kind of workload. Or where you will have smaller random read write, suppose your database storage you are enabling, so in that case, suppose data files are getting stored where you will be like keep on writing or retrieving data, so in that case also you will be able to use Cinder. And also if you have high or bursty IO, so where you will have more IO flows like either inflow or outflow, in that situation also Cinder is a ideal candidate to use. So there are a couple of features that there in Cinder. So first of all, it enables you to create and delete volume. So you can either create or you can delete volume. Also, you can have your specific custom or extra specifications for your Cinder storage. Also, you can clone the volume. So suppose you have a volume attached to a instance, and if you want to clone that particular volume to have the data backed up there, you can do the cloning. Also, you can copy image to volume and vice versa. So that means suppose you have image uploaded in Glance, you can convert that as a volume and then attach to any running instance, or you have a running instance where you have attached volume, you can convert that as an image. Also, creating point in time copies, or what you can say like snapshots of volume, is possible in your Cinder. And also, once you take the snapshot, you can again convert that snapshot to volume to attach it in another system. So suppose you have an application server where you are storing the data, and same data you want to have available in another server, which one you are building out newly. So in that situation, you can take a snapshot of that particular volume and then convert that volume snapshot to again a volume and then attach that to the new instance, so that you have the same data available there. Also, Cinder gives you that option to backup your volumes, so that you can do it either on your object store, that or you can do it on Swift, and also you can do it on a third party or other storage solutions like Safe Storage and all, where you can backup your volumes. And also you can transfer the ownership for your volume. And one more thing you can do in Cinder, that's like suppose you have a total 1000 GB of storage available inside your OpenStack environment, and you don't want to give entire 1000 GB to a particular project or particular user to consume. So in that situation, what you can do, you can set up a quota for per project wise. So suppose you are having a project, let's call project A, there you want to have up to 250 GB of storage it can consume. So in that situation, you can have a quota limit set for that particular project, so that they cannot eat up the entire available space from your Cinder. So that is possible. So there are a couple of supported backend storage are available for Cinder. So like as I was already mentioning, like Safe Storage you can have as a backend. You can have Swift or Object Store also as a backend storage for your Cinder, or you can have like 3PAR or EMC storage or Dell storage solutions as a supported backend. But here one thing you need to remember, before you go and select any storage backend, please review the requirement of the user. So as per their requirement, you have to select proper supported storage background, so that you can optimize or get the full features out of it. And that you can do by asking the right question to the users before going and selecting your or deciding your storage backend solution. Also, Cinder provides a plugin architecture which enables you to have multiple choices for your backend storage. So suppose you want to use Safe Storage, that is possible, or you want to use some third party storage solution like 3PAR or EMC storage or Dell storage. So that is possible by the Cinder plugin. And one good thing for Cinder is like it not only works on few proprietary storage solutions, it also works on open source storage solution. So both are supported. So if you have a proprietary storage solution available, you may be able to use that, or if you have any open source storage solution inside your environment, that also you can leverage with your Cinder. And if you want to see the full supported list, please refer to the latest official documents available in OpenStack website, so that you can have an idea of what all backend storage are supported, or what all features you will be getting for those backend storages. So here are the various components for Cinder. So first component is Cinder API. So API, by from the name itself you can understand, so it accepts the API request. So if user or any other component of your OpenStack wants to call Cinder or interact with Cinder via API, it will be using Cinder API. Also one more thing it does, actually it routes the request to Cinder volume for action. So suppose you want to use a volume, or you want to create or delete a volume, in that situation you will be sending that request via Cinder API, and eventually that request will be routed to your Cinder volume component for further processing. So as I was telling you that Cinder volume, so that is the second component for Cinder. So what is the Cinder volume? So it responds to requested to read or write from a block storage database to maintain state. Also Cinder volume interacts with other processes through messaging queue, like with the Cinder scheduler, so or via Cinder API. So it keep a connectivity with all these other components. It also interacts directly with hardware or software providing block storage. So suppose you have a backend storage solution, it can talk directly with that storage solution for further processing, and this is been done via particular storage provider driver. So you will have these drivers already enabled, so that you can use the driver to interact with the backend software or hardware storage solution. So the third component here is Cinder scheduler. It's the same like Nova scheduler, which goes and checks all that backend available backend storages and see which one needs how much storage available, or how they're utilized. So if they're overutilized or they're utilizing almost in full capacity, then it will not consider that, and it will look for the other backend storage which are having less resource consumption and can be giving you optimum performance. So Cinder scheduler does that job. Then you have a component called Cinder backup. So what is this Cinder backup? By the name itself we can understand it gives you the backup capability inside your Cinder. So it helps to backup your volumes to backup storage provider, or you can go and store in some other storage solutions also, backup solutions, and it interact with storage providers through driver. So this backup also interacts with various storage providers via the specific hardware driver. And then last component of your Cinder is messaging queue. So this is the main component inside your Cinder to interact between various components. So suppose if your Cinder scheduler wants to talk with your Cinder volume or Cinder backup, so it goes and talk via this messaging queue to have the communication done. So here are few basic commands for your Cinder. So to create volume, you can use the command called OpenStack volume create. Then you specify the size by hyphen hyphen size. One thing you need to remember here is like whatever number you put, that is in GB. So suppose if you are putting 10, so that means it will have a 10 GB volume created. And then you specify the name, like suppose you want to give like my volume, or you want to give like data vol, or data suppose log volume, so to store the log. So like descriptive name, by from that you can understand this volume is for particular this purpose. And two, if you want to see the list of volumes already created inside your OpenStack, use the command OpenStack volume list. And if you want to see the detailed information about a particular volume, use the command OpenStack volume show and then the volume ID. And to delete a volume is fairly easy. You use the command OpenStack volume delete and then the volume ID. And extending volume size is also possible. So to do that, you have to use a command called OpenStack volume set, and then you give the volume ID, and then you put the size, that hyphen size, whatever new size you are providing. And to attach or detach volume to Nova instances, you use the command OpenStack server, add volume and then instance name and the volume name. So this will be helpful once you create a new volume and want to attach that to a running instance. And suppose you want to remove that volume from your running instance, you do the command OpenStack server remove volume and then instance name volume name. So it will remove that volume from that particular instance. So then next topic is ephemeral storage. So what is this ephemeral storage? So this is the storage which also comes from your Cinder and it associated with single or unique instances. So one ephemeral storage will be attached to only one single unique instance, and the size of this ephemeral storage depends on the flavor you are using. So flavor is nothing but the hardware template. So like suppose how much CPU will have, how much memory will have, so that template called flavor. So depends on that flavor your size of ephemeral disk varies. And one more thing you need to remember, when you terminate any instance, so that also deletes this ephemeral storage. So if you have saving some data inside this ephemeral storage and if you are terminating that instance, in that situation your all the data you kept inside the disk will be lost. And one more thing you need to remember, if this only applies when you are terminating the instances. So if you are, in case if you are rebooting your instance, in that situation that whatever data you are storing inside your ephemeral disk will not get deleted. So this is the difference between the temporary disk you get in your Azure cloud and here. So in Azure cloud, what happens, whatever you are storing inside that particular temporary drive, it gets cleaned up on every reboot. So in this case it doesn't get deleted, it is a persistent storage. Until unless you are deleting that instance, this data will be available all the time. So what is the common usage for this ephemeral storage, you might be thinking. If you are working in a traditional data center architecture, this concept you never seen. So it is more often used in your OpenStack cloud to have your root file system stored on the ephemeral disk. And one thing you need to remember, all the default flavors having this ephemeral block device defined except the m1.tiny, that is the smallest flavor available in your OpenStack environment. And this size for the ephemeral disk varies from 20 GB to 160 GB in the default setup. So now if you are creating by yourself any flavor, in that situation you may give any size whichever is suitable for your setup, but in a default flavors you will be seeing it starting from 20 GB to and then goes up to 160 GB. And then one thing you need to remember, when you attach any ephemeral storage to a running VM or instance, so that storage being presented as a raw block device. So it's more like you're attaching a SANS LAN or hard disk directly to a VM. So how you get, like without any partitioning or without any file system on that, it just get attached as a raw device. So you have to create partition and file system on that to have that in use inside your VM. So until unless you are doing that, you will not be able to use this ephemeral storage device. And then if you are having any cloud aware operating system, so that can easily discover and format this ephemeral storage and then mount it inside the server and to use it. So suppose if you are having a Ubuntu image, it can easily detect this and then it formats this as a ext3 file system and then mount it on MNT so that you can use this ephemeral storage inside your instance. So this is the Cinder workflow. In Cinder workflow, you have like OpenStack block storage service implemented by Cinder API, and then you have the scheduler, you have the volume, and you have the backup services, and all the services intercommunicate with each other through messaging queue or messaging bus, whatever you say, like AMQP. And also you get the data from your Cinder database. And Sinter API service provides access point to block storage users. So suppose user wants to talk to the Sinter, it connects via API service. So it implements a RESTful API to Sinter object. So like it creates a RESTful API for volume, snapshot, backups, volume types, then quotas and volume attachment. Sinter database reflects the Sinter object state. Now if you want to do a new volume selection, in that case when user initiate volume creation, Sinter API sends messages to the Sinter scheduler. Then scheduler responds for selecting backend on which to place new volume. So what it does before creating or placing that volume in the backend storage, it collects the state and capability data of different backend. Then it checks with their on their free space availability and capabilities to find out which is the best backend available for that request, and then it creates the volume on that particular backend storage which is less utilized or having the enough free space available to accommodate that volume. Now when you go for a volume service inside your Sinter, the workflow looks like this. So scheduler gets the data from Sinter volume service. Then once it gets the data, what it does on volume service typically responsible for one storage pool. So you will have this volume service which will be like associated with a storage pool, and then OpenStack Cloud can have multiple volume services. So if you have multiple storage pool, you can have multiple volume services. So this Sinter volume service is consist of generic code which implements high level flow and then communicate with database and then perform quota update. So suppose if you are updating your quota, suppose you are setting up a quota like 100 GB only can user use in this project, and then you are creating a 10 GB of volume, then that use quota details also get updates via Sinter volume service. And this volume service also consists of drivers. So these drivers contain the backend specific code. So suppose if you are using a safe storage as a backend storage solution, in that case your volume service will be having the driver for that particular safe storage to work with. Then to implement operations on volumes, volume service sends request to storage pool via corresponding driver. And if you want to have a backup inside your Sinter workflow, what it does, OpenStack block storage service can backup volume. So this backup service implements backup function. So suppose you want to have a backup function inside your Sinter to take a backup of volumes, you can have the backup service enabled there. So this service also has high level generic part and drivers that communicate with backend. Why you need a driver? Because in backup also you need to go and again read the volumes to have a backup of that to store. So for that reason it will have the drivers also to communicate with the specific backend storage solution. So on one more thing you can see, like as an example, like Sinter backup can use OpenStack Swift as a storage backend for backup. So still now you know that OpenStack Swift is the object storage service available inside your OpenStack platform, but Sinter can use that also as a backup storage to keep the backup of the volumes. So this is the Sinter workflow diagram looks like. So suppose you have you are trying to connect with your Sinter service. So what you do when you try to interact, it comes via to OpenStack Sinter API. Then this API communicate via messaging broker with OpenStack Sinter backup service and also scheduler service and also Sinter volume. So now suppose you want to take a backup, what it does, that Sinter API goes and talk with the Sinter backup service, and then that backup service goes and take that particular volume backup and keeps it into the backup repository. In the same time, if you are supposed to want to create a new volume, what it does, that Sinter API service communicates with your Sinter scheduler. Scheduler goes back and checks in the database also to find out the backend storages available and also configuration. Then it goes and checks all that attached backend storages and to find out who has enough space available to create the volume and also who has less resource utilization, so that it can create on a more better performing backend storage to have a better optimized outcome. So once you done with your Sinter installation, so mainly what you do, you install the Sinter service on your controller node. So controller node then will be providing the block storage services to all the running instances. So your lab build out, once you are done with Sinter, will be looking like this, where you can see control node is running with MariaDB, RabbitMQ, Keystone, Nova, Neutron, Glance also along with Sinter.